Welcome back, everyone. This is a stream. Yeah, I started the stream. So, this week, it's a Tuesday again. I'm a bit late if you tune into the stream, but I'm always on time when you tune in on YouTube. So, this week, we're going to look again at the URL status view model. I was in the process of changing the old SwiftUI view model approach that I came up with during my experiments, and I'm going to change it to, wait a second, do not disturb, yes, and I wanted to change it to be testable, so the components make more sense, and so the SwiftUI views themselves don't do that much after all, which is the overarching goal when it seems it's the overarching goal when you write SwiftUI views. Make them do the least amount of work possible. And yeah, to get started, you see there's a view model test for other status values. I think this was just about where we left off last time. Have a look at the view. Font size should be humongous, huge, without compare. Let's just run the test. Command U. This time, no setup required. Just compile. Just test. Please, do it. This is all still very confusing. I'm not a SwiftUI pro, and I would really like to check out Objective-C-I-O. I think Chris Eitoff released a book. Swift Essentials now. Thinking, yes. Thinking in SwiftUI. Chris Eitoff and Florian Kugler. Thinking in SwiftUI is a very good title. It's possibly the best title for a book I could imagine. Of this scope. Because because that's the problem, isn't it? If you come from iOS and AppKit or UIKit and AppKit and know MVC and the basics of writing apps, and then you try to dive into SwiftUI, this is tough. It's tough because things are written so differently. These modifiers, can I zoom in a bit here? Yeah. These modifiers like, oh yeah, let's show test, tap me, and then make a modifier like foreground color and the text should be white. Okay. And it's inside of the button, so it's a button label and the button itself has padding, which means internal, like an inset between the button border and the text corner. And the button itself has a black background color and a border corner radius, but it's not the button's foreground color, it's the button's label text foreground color you're setting. And this is still pretty straightforward if you read examples of SwiftUI views a couple of times. But coming up with this is super hard. It's super hard. You can apply the foreground color modifier. Yes, it's apparently called a modifier, although it's just, you know, a method call, and that modifies the view. You can call this on almost anything, and it does different things in different contexts. And prying these open and understanding them, yeah, it's tough. Ooh, they have so many books that they can come up with a $300 bundle already. That's nice. Also, didn't know they have a paperback edition. Do I want paperback or ebook? I don't know. I just read this on Twitter that there is this book and there's an exercise. Are there exercises inside? So I wanted to check this out later today or this week, and then have a look at how they approach this. Also very nice, I think, is I believe all their books are based on Markdown manuscripts or typo scripts, and they compile this stuff themselves. And I wonder, do they also do this with the graphics? That would be cool. For me, at least, because I'm compiling electronic publications from time to time as well, I'm using LaTeX to make PDF manuscripts for printing, and I'm just interested in tooling. So, this would be, this is the basics of layout and then geometry and, damn it. The really interesting stuff to me is how do you architect, let's say, how do you architect an application? Book contents, preferences, advanced layout, view layout animations. Okay, so this seems to be sorry for the bang. So this seems to be focused on the Swift UI view part. And maybe there's another book, App Architecture, would be possibly applicable. There's so many things you can do. Like Swift UI is architecture agnostic, but at the same time, you have to get data there some way or another. Anyway, just rambling. Wait until I drink this. Should only get worse. Okay, test's finished in the background, like maybe 10 minutes ago or something. And what I did here last time was I wrote view model tests for the add now page form view model. This is the thing that subscribes to events, the combine sequences and does test equations asynchronously based on timeouts. And this is using entwine tests, which I imported last time. This was new. And I imported this because I want to have a way to specify at which time which event is supposed to fire and then make assertions on the time that the combination of events arrive. And with vanilla combine syncs and reducings and stuff, this is not easily possible. So these wrappers are super useful. And also you ditch the asynchrony. You don't have to wait for real world time to pass to make the tests pass. You can just tell the scheduler to pretend it's creating an input event with a nil payload at time 300. And then tell the test scheduler to start and produce and fire events to this, I know, and then observe and consume events from here and also wrap these in. These are status events, and these are that's a shitty type name to explain. These are the view model events, and these produce events of type status. And wrapping this in the scheduler start method is receiving these events or observing events that come in through this pipeline and attaches the fake clock's time to this event. So at time 300, this event is produced, nothing should happen. At time 400, this event is produced, something should happen. An event is produced from here and then goes to the left into the results. And this is what you do assertions for. You assert that the subscription is at time, that's when the subscription is made, which is always, by convention, always at time 200. This is when the start method is calling and setting up the subscriptions and observation protocol thingamabobs. And also, we expect an initial state to be published at the same time. 200, 200. And at time 400, which is this event, at this event's time, we expect another output to be produced. Okay, so that's it for the recap. Really nice, I love it. But if you have a look at the macOS app, see. This happened. This is not great. That's a label, that's a text box, and that's a status indicator. And this is also a label, I think. But we end up with a table-like situation, or a grid-like situation, and this doesn't make sense. It didn't look this way on Big Sur when I had the Xcode 13 beta version. This is regression. It might even look better on Big Sur now, but I don't have Big Sur available, so who knows? It looks like this on Monterey, and that's not good. And I think Monterey is going to be the deployment target in the end. Should maybe. Maybe I should denote this here. I don't want to test for macOS 11. Let's just start with macOS 12. Monterey is the current version. And when I'm done with the app, it's probably macOS 14. So plenty of time for forward support. But I'll close the app. But the form, that's the, it's not good. Where's the form view? Let me collapse the sidebar so there's more real estate on screen. I haven't tried previews in a while. But new MacBook, new macOS, new Xcode version. This looks less shitty because it has more room. But it reveals more of what's happening. I can click on things. Okay, wait. Haha. Didn't know this is a thing. Form section header website. Mm-hmm. It's probably meant to be center. No, this is centered. Where's this? If not on macOS, but we are on macOS. Don't have titles, so we cannot see navigation title at all. Aha. Is this automatically center aligned? I'm just typing align and see what modifiers we have. Min max alignment. Does this compile, or do I need width and height? No. Does this also work with trailing? Should move to the right. Doesn't do anything, as is often the case. Yeah, problem could be that this thing here is... No, it's fine. Okay, this is good because this is a private function and it's still working. Is still a view builder, so the preview does pick up that my helper method here is doing the thing. Do we have anything else? Okay, this would align text probably inside of the rectangle, and because the rectangle is snugly tight, there's no visual change. Aha. So we would want to move it to the right. I don't really want to, but if we wanted to align it to the right, this would mean that this stack element needs... Not the text inside needs alignment, but maybe this would need... Trailing. That work? No. As always, I have no clue. Okay, but this was just my curiosity, and this didn't lead anywhere. I have no clue how to move text to the right. That's great. Okay. But where's the website coming from? This is the section header. Blah, blah, blah. Okay. New subscription. Do we need this? Is this because iOS? I don't know which iPhone did I use. Let's try the mini because it doesn't take that much on screen space. I have no clue. I really have no clue. I don't want. This is a very simple form. It has one text field, one label, and this label. This label should be enough. We don't need website label here, label there. The website label should go away. But I think for iOS we want this as a semantic unit. On iOS there's layout constraint problems. Okay. Yeah, and here we have this group stuff and the URL e.g. http://servers.org/now. This is a placeholder value. Hello. See, it does stuff. It now looks better on iOS than it does on macOS. Section header on macOS is weird. Also, this is weird. And then there's a URL view inside. So the form itself is just a wrapper with the section header, which I don't enjoy. The question is, does this already ready warrant splitting this up from the shared group into an iOS and macOS variant? Maybe, because we have a platform dependent code here. We want to have platform dependent code here. Making another, if this is macOS, then don't show section header. Yeah, this I don't believe this scales well. This is rather the opposite of scaling. What actually is the opposite of scaling? Unscaling? It's getting worse with scale? Don't know. Yeah, so this, not good. But this is teaching us that there's this now page URL view. And I want a preview, please. I don't have a preview, probably, because I don't have a preview provider. Do we need a group? Also, what is okay? We can have an empty form view model. Do we need the group? Is this in a group? No. Why was the form in a group? Aha. This is what I want. This is not what I'm getting. Placeholder in the text field. Enforce HTTPS modifier. Okay, this is prefixing the HTTPS as the user is typing. Does that break anything? Let's have a look without the view modifier. Nope. Why is this not inside? Where label is view? Is this label? Username, blah, blah, blah. Proper name, value, format, name style, medium? Data formatting. What do we have? Do we have a URL? ESO date. List local format string. No. Why not? First name components. Name components, style, medium. To convert the name type in a text field to. That's the medium style. These are the components, that's the model. URL formatter. No. Better search. Still no results. Yikes. Okay, so I'm not quite sure. First, I'm not sure why this looks different. What are these buttons? Oh, it's previewing in the app. What is this? Okay, no tooltip, this is pinning. Variable content, modifiers, text argument of new value. This is a label, the URL label. It's happening on macOS. It's shown here, so I expect this preview to be a macOS preview. Otherwise, it should be conditionally compiled out. Maybe. But maybe it's iOS running on macOS, and this is not the compilation. No, it's not runtime, it's compile time. I don't know. Okay, let's have a look at what text field can do. Text field in Swift UI. You create a field with a label value to blah blah blah. Auto updating, text view changes colors, the user begins and ends editing. Interesting. This suspiciously looks like a placeholder, but it's not displaying in the app as a placeholder. Why is that? I don't know. Text field. Prompt text, prompt label. Text prompt label. How is this not working? Value format prompt label. Is this only available in... Ah, this is new. Maybe that's why I didn't use it, because I was on Big Sur. Maybe. Format style of type F to use when converting string. Dot number. How does it know? Value format label. There's no label because I'm not using the label thing. What if I would be using the label thing? Text label. The label subview builder something something. Title. Title of the text field describing its purpose. Value format prompt. Also has a prompt. Prompt is supposed to be text. Label value format. Prompt not shown. Also macOS 12. Value of arbitrary type. Arbitrary, yes, that's me. Formatter. Can perform the conversion. Blah blah blah. Title, we had that, yes. Why is nobody using the prompt? What to enter? This should be the placeholder, right? Also should be a text thingy. But where's label going? Label's going here. Yeah, that's more like it. That is more like it. This should be URL. Prompt is the placeholder, text is the value, and then there's no first parameter. Value isn't shown here, so the preview is not up to speed. And it's left aligning with the, whatever this is, some layout guide. Okay. This should not be there. This should be hidden initially. No problem. Sivers org. Yeah, it's a URL that works. Okay. What does it look like on iOS? Init is only available iOS 15. Okay. Then we use iOS 15. No problemo. Website. Label is not used. Cool. So label is ignored. I just type Sivers and then the HTTPS is appended, prepended. Sorry. I cannot delete it because the view modifier ensures that the text, I press backspace. This is a backspace key. Nothing happens. Cool, cool. Okay. Okay. Let's cherry pick the changes. Full screen. Git thingy. Erase macOS and iOS deployment target to for latest Swift UI. And this is enable preview in now page URL view form element. And this here is replacing. Is it a fix or is it replacing? Is it, what is it? It has something to do with the placeholder and label. Fix placeholder and label format in macOS and iOS. Push. Did it push? Still pushing? Okay. Back to the form view. Resume. This is not the current preview. Please update. Please update faster. Prepare simulator for previews. Aha. Okay, but I want the macOS preview. Okay, so this was macOS after all. This looks less bad. way less bad. Okay. This annoys me. It's really useful on. Well, maybe there's new form API form Swift UI. Overview section header notifications. Okay, this is for multi-step forms. On macOS, a similar form renders as a vertical stack. To adhere macOS platform convention doesn't use sections and uses colons at the end of its labels. That's a bad sign because this is a different view implementation. Picker to use inline style, which produces radio buttons. That looks more like macOS, but also. Oh no. They're using tag to identify form elements. Why? Well, picker here, picker there, section, no section. Okay, Apple, if this is how you want to play this game, I'm sad, but also up to the challenge. Shared macOS. This is absolutely breaking the project structure. Is it breaking the project structure in a good way? Okay, that was a rename. So it's now on the macOS thingy. Since we're in macOS, now let's first also paste this into the iOS group. Hello. One is a rename, one is an addition. All right. Sheet title, new subscription, form section. Yes, yes, yes. Form wrapper, if not macOS. This is indeed what we have, not macOS. Contents dot blah, blah, blah. Contents are the insights. Navigation bar title. Yep, that should be it. Keyboard shortcut cancel action. Not even sure if I should remove keyboard shortcuts. iOS target, macOS target. All right. Okay, here the opposite is going to happen. We are removing. Copying this over, replacing the form wrapper. Since macOS 11 dialogues don't have titles, yes, text sheet title, front headline, blah blah blah. Contents was the view builder, which is this. Moving this up, removing this. All right. Have a look. And now I'm going to remove this section. And we're golden. Yep. It's a very boring form. Why does the form itself not have the buttons? Ah, because it's displayed inside of a dialogue. Ah, well, this is cannot preview, scheme does not build. Yeah, then use the other scheme. Do we need the group? I'm going to remove it. Maybe the group was there. No, I don't know why the group is there. Nothing exploded. Sheet title, new subscription, send navigation bar title. Let's do manual integration testing. Show me everything. Nerdcounterapp.com. No. Seems to work. Body content on the page failed. That's good, but it did something. Form looked alright to me. Let's try macOS again. Did the project change? No. Just the file move and duplication. Yes. Let's add now page form view. Separate. Add now page form view. iOS from macOS. There's the app. Add now page. WordCounterApp.com. Bing. Add. Hello. Yes. Very nice. Okay. Okay, so that's something. Was this a to-do here somewhere? Add subscription macOS form layout. Fixed. Write VM test for other status values. Close this. Back to the test. Is that the test? No. This. Status without URL. Yeah. This is indicating we're testing the status without the URL. That's one variation. And we are not testing any other. Perform network activity, then it produces a pending status. So copy paste, where's my mouse cursor? Copy paste to the rescue. The next would be, do I remember this from the top of my head? I would expect this to be, no URL, not pending. To be invalid, no URL, and it's finished. What do you say, Mr. Test? Mrs. Test? I don't know. Just to have a look if the test is broken. No, this is indeed an invalid state. Okay, that makes sense. Now I'm copying both of them and with URL, and this is with URL. URL and network activity means, yeah, that's a weird combo. This means we had a URL in the past, probably. How else would the URL arrive? So this is the sequences are staying subscribed. So we get multiple URL events, multiple pending network events, and then over time, there's still the last URL event is still known, but then a new network event is happening, and whenever the network activity is being performed, it is in a pending state. I don't care, irrelevant URL, which URL is being passed, but it means not performing before. This maybe means that we have a valid URL in between. Let's have a look. Maybe this doesn't fire though. Mm-mm. Nope, doesn't fire. Why does it not fire? Hmm. Why does this not fire? We will see in a second. But first, I'm going to mute myself and spend 5 minutes doing pull-ups and stuff like that to not have ass rot, as Xali uses to say. See you in a second. Okay, I'm back. Where was I? Here? Yeah. This does not produce a valid URL. Why not? Can we produce a URL without producing a network activity first? Should we want to? Have a look. Don't have a look there. Yes. Combine latest. Yes, combine latest requires both to fire at least once. Just URL produces a valid status. No events here. Then I want valid input at time 444. This is a slip. What? This is supposed to be a slimmed, trimmed, diet version of the test that we just had failing a second ago. Should also fail. Yes, it's failing. Because we just get subscribed and initial input and then nothing. And I think we want to... oh no, Xcode indentation. Why? Start with... description start with? No. Start. This enum case is defined by matching time. Okay, what is combine latest getting? Publisher, publisher, publisher. Combine publishers. Okay. You didn't want it any other way. Collect, ignore, reduce, no, count, man, mix, man, contains, no, drop, append, no, prepend. Prefixes, output, sequence, yes. It's called starts with, no, start with in Rx Swift. Why is this the correct indentation? Why is this the correct indentation? What? How? Sorry, Xcode, but you're drunk. All right, then I'm doing this manually. 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay. So we want to prepend with no network activity, so we don't need initial element. Does it work? Do we get something else in between? Aha, pending. Pending? 400? Where's the 400 coming off from? Subscribed initial pending at 400. Also, the test is passing. I think this is not up to date. Run all the tests. Okay. Have a look. Just URL. I want to reorder these. adjust URL produces valid status. With URL performing network activity is pending. So we get valid first, pending at 400. This is probably the 400 that was copy-pasted earlier. No network activity produces. Does this produce a new event? I hope not. I hope not. If we have an irrelevant URL and then false, which is not a, it's not even a change. I need another test for a sequence, a dummy sequence to verify that. So initially we have initial stuff. At 300 we will have a valid, and at 500 we don't need to change anything. It should stay the same. This should not do anything just because network doesn't do stuff. It should invalidate when the pending activity is true. It should not revalidate if the same false is triggered. But should it trigger true? I'm not sure. What is initial invalid pending, initial invalid, no. Aha. 300 is triggering invalid because we're now. This is not a proper story. The network activity would usually start first. Initial invalid pending, invalid pending. Without URL, with URL, what? Without URL, oh, this is what I was editing. Performing network activity, without URL, no network activity. Invalid at 300. 500 should not do anything. I believe this is hard to reason about. Surprisingly hard, because yeah, what do we expect from some of these states? Of course, 500 is going to trigger something again. Does it hurt? No. I believe it does not hurt, but can we maybe remove duplicates. Because do we need valid? Do we need to trigger an update? I don't think so. There's nothing at this location, Xcode. Thanks for trying. I hate this. Okay, now the tab switcher is back again. Second monitor is swallowing the application switcher. If you click in the dock there, I want just the main screen to be responsible for this, but alas, it is the way it is. Okay, test and implement URL status view model event. Testing state transitions. I'm always writing past the line here. Push. Okay. Write VM tests, done. Also done. Map to status. Yep, we've got that covered now. This is the mapping from states to statuses. Status View, View Model, it's an observable object, which means that its published property is the thing that can be observed, and the observable object magic here is doing something to the status view, relying on the observed object passive past. And whatever tense, at least passive tense. Just nil, also just nil. We don't need this. We can use the new status thingy. No? No. It's a class, so we could be. Yeah, I think that's too invasive. Do I want to switch this in the preview? I guess not. Just true. Is there something like an infinite repeating sequence? Just publisher that emits an output and then finishes. Tell me about other publishers. Adjust publisher. That's better than an unjust publisher. Am I right? Empty, just, future. Future and deferred is different. Eventually produces a single value. Publisher that awaits subscription before running. So this is a cold. Hot and cold publisher. Hot and cold subscription. Not sure who's hot, who's cold, but this is the cold thing. Let's say cold publisher. Fail, just fail. That's a just with no element. Record. Recording a series and a completion for later playback. I want a repeating record series. Is that a thing? Because I'm not bothering to. I don't bother writing that just for this preview. From decoder, in, out, recording, recording, output, record, publisher, publisher, provider, format, system, smell, bump. Completion. Just one element. Yep. Okay, okay. Let's not bother. This is one a kind of preview. Fine with that. Status icon modifier, foreground color, blah blah blah. I didn't remember that I extracted a color modifier. Yeah, why not? But I read somewhere. Maybe. I took note of this in resources. Blah blah blah. Environment object. No. 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 Programmatic. I wanted a new window, please. Programmatic navigation in SwiftUI. Discover, blah, blah, blah. Switching tabs. Programmatic navigation. I needed that for what exactly? I don't know. Fev icons. The Fev icons are not fetched. Also not cached, not stored anywhere. I don't remember how I store anything. Is anything stored at all? State. Model. and represents a cached slash now page snapshot. Modified fetched ID title URL icon. No icon here. Updated at formatter. Why don't I have an icon type? I need foundation for the date. CG image would be AppKit or UIKit. Updated at formatter. Set date formatter. Isn't formatter a protocol? Abstract class. No, thank you. Last update fetched at. Okay. Then we have a state. This is the application state. And you see, I didn't start with this if you dig into the logs, but I eventually switched to ReSwift because I could not wrap my head around state management in plain Swift UI. I couldn't, but I tried, but I couldn't. What's going on here? We have an app store. Well, it's not the app store. App store, it's the store for the app state. And this is the app state. The app state is here. The app state is comprised of an array of now snapshots. We had a look at the now snapshots just a second ago. That's this. This is a representation of one page snapshot. This is not persisted at all. I can remember this now. So we have nothing, but also a snapshot. Yes. App state with a snapshot. How are the snapshots produced? These are the reducers. They receive actions or events and produce state updates. This is an update for the whole state based on this event. And the whole state update is comprised of updates to the substates. So there's substate reducers as well. Yep. Action as replace snapshots. That's one action. It just replaces the whole snapshot thingy. You can delete a single page. Delete now page, but this is called snapshot. Add now page, delete now page, replace snapshots. There's a mismatch. It's replacing snapshots, but it's not deleting snapshots. Should it delete snapshots, or was this an intention I cannot remember? So, okay. And if the for any other action, it's just passing back the original state. Do we need the optional? I believe no. So now we can ditch this and thus remove these optional fallbacks. Fingers crossed. Kind of works. I don't have tests for this. Because I didn't want to solidify this. Why did I not want to solidify this? Because I wasn't sure if I want to keep ReSwift as a dependency. And also the approach to action state reducing that I employ here. Why not? I picked this because I was comfortable with it. You can dispatch actions from basically anywhere. Like have a button very deep in the view hierarchy. It dispatches an action. The action reaches the store. This is a store. The store has Can we look at this? Yeah. The store has a dispatch method, and this is where the actions are dispatched. It does, well, a lot of stuff under the hood, but it basically, in the end, it passes the action through all the middleware and then to the reducers, so we eventually end up here. And then we get a new app state. Period. This is what happens. Action comes in. It can be dispatched from anywhere as long as you have a reference to the app store, application, app state, to the central store of the state. Then you can dispatch an action and it will handle a state update and then inform all the subscribers about the new state of the new state. So that is nice, but it's basically a roundabout way for managing a central global singleton state variable in a more sophisticated way. What's also nice is that you can have middlewares. And what does this do? This encapsulates the URL request. So we get the add now page. Add now page is an action with multiple substates. It can be an incoming request from the app to please add a now page of this URL. This is being progressed then, and then it produces a result. So the middleware is sitting in the pipeline of action to state mappings, and it receives the request, and the request is then actually swallowed. This request action is never reaching the reducer. The middleware receives this and then intercepts. It intercepts the requests only, the request variant, and then it produces an in-progress action instead. This could, like, put the app into a pending state, very similar to the spinning loading indicator next to the URL view. I believe we don't use this for anything at the moment. So this is the actually passed on action. The next action that is being passed on is not the original action, that would be this. It's not the original action, it's a replacement action. It's the in-progress action. Then the network request is being performed on the network request queue. It's a background queue. It handles the URL request, the Kana library, performs the request and... Okay. The Kana library performs the request and tries to read the HTML, and then the result is being mapped to from HTML document to a now snapshot. So remember, the now snapshot is this model. The URL is known from the URL request, but the title isn't known. The latest update isn't known. The content isn't known. Also, the fev icon, once it's supported, isn't known. So this is transforming the HTML page downloaded from the web when it finished downloading into a now snapshot using this convenience initializer that does a lot of stuff here, like extract the actual now page body if it exists. If it does not exist, well, then just look for the main element, body, content, article, whatever. And if it all fails, then we get this message. And you remember that this message was displayed in the page for, let's see, the wordcounterapp.com, which is my own page. Enter, add. Okay, so the shortcuts don't work. This is committing the text field, but it's not committing the form. Maybe command enter. No, that's doing ping, 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 ping. Have to click this. Okay. make enter return commit the add now page URL form. And then we have this. Last time I looked, this didn't work. Now it does work. It extracts something. Sign in when you sign to WordCount to get access to. Oops, the wrong page. No right click menu. Okay, delete. Delete now page. Do we want to delete this subscription? That's also not very helpful to do. Deletion dialog. Show. Replace generic delete now page title with actual subscription title. Yes. WordCounterApp.com. Also, to do deleting subscription should unselect element IE show nothing selected in the content view pane. Maybe content pane. The old content lingered. Also, to do adding a subscription should auto select new element, i.e. show the content in the right hand side, in on the right hand side, on the right hand side, yeah. Select in list plus show the content on the right hand side. And this is what we get. WordCounter for macOS. My app does not have a main or content or article thing that is being parsed. So we get this. Finding the body content on the page failed. Not saying that this is the best way to do this and this is final, but this is doing something. Looks for a main element, look for a content element or ID content or any article to extract the content and ignore menus and stuff like that. But no such luck on the WordCounterApp.com page. And then this is a convenience initializer that eventually calls the actual initializer. Okay, so this is extracting content from HTML pages. All right, so that's happening here. Success, failure. So we get the add now page result, which is this. And this is being processed. This is being processed here in the new now snapshot reducer. In the add now page case result success. Failure states aren't handled at all. That's probably not good. To do handle add now page result failure. Case and tests at least, because I don't know how to trigger them, because if the URL isn't valid then we cannot get that file in the app, so server must respond with something and then fail during the loading. That is the problem when you don't write tests for your states and your state reducers, then you don't cover all the cases. And it doesn't say here on the tin. Okay. So that is what we have. And this is not what we necessarily want to keep. Text validation with cleanup filtering as you type. Validate input and text field is this. Does this refer to the URL setter? Maybe. Unreceived, just validate a text, bla bla bla. Print new value, yeah, maybe. Oh, since we can check the unchange. Don't know. Text validation, cleanup is your type. HTTPS URL validation. Why HTTPS? Because I'm not sure if we can even request HTTP pages by default. Not doing a lot of HTTP requests in my apps. And this is done. Image cache with merge many, including, what is this? Publishers merge many, fetch cached favorites, fetch favorites, replace error with blah, 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 assign to products. It's potentially interesting. This would be image cache, including cache. Okay, including cache. Yeah, that's okay. This would be potentially interesting to have a cache source for URL of a fev icon and also request the image if necessary, but we're not there yet. Fetch website image avatar fev icon. This list does not scale well. Local disk cache. Do not store in database. That's a good remark, past Christian. Maybe. Or do we want to use ubiquitous thingy from iCloud? Look into storing images in iCloud and ubiquitous. Ubiquitous store. Maybe. Or use the autocompletion in this application that I modded myself is less than ideal. There's no reason to not use outline items. List items, the title, preview text. Yes, we have that. We have that. Yet URL to store in in-memory array. Yes, that is the state fetch actual website. Yes, auto prepend HTTPS. Yes. Add, delete, reorder. Ooh, reorder. Swipe actions. No. Pressing some button involuntarily. What is also done is obtain page contents. Web page contents and show text in app. Apple, no. Programmatic selection of newly created list items. I remember that I just wrote about this. No. Delete that line. Where is it? Adding a subscription to auto select. Yes. Core Data and iCloud Sync. How to configure Core Data to use. Mm-hmm. This could start for everything but the items, the icons. Where are the icons? Handle now page result failure. Reorder pages manually. Website image avatar. Add reorder. Mm-hmm. To do Sync iOS and macOS via iCloud. Store selected ID in the user defaults, restore on next launch. Mm-hmm. State restoration, to do state restoration of the app. Remember selection. Programmatic selection with NavLink. On iOS there is what's it called? State restoration. Preservation. State preservation API used for view controller. State persistence as well. Projection sort by last updated. Projection, what? Why projection? That's a very technical term, but I don't recall what the idea was. Currently shows one line. Actually, it only shows metadata, but you could also make a case for showing a preview here. Mm-hmm. Does this translate to macOS in any way? Because what I just said was the opposite of the truth. It wasn't a lie, it was just something else. This is what I... Hello, please show something. Yeah, this is what I meant, what I'm doing now, blah, blah, blah. These are four lines of text. Maybe five? No, this doesn't count. Four lines of text, and this could be customizable. I can't scroll, I'd have to drag. Mm-hmm. All right, make text selectable before iOS macOS 12. How do I allow text selection and text label in SwiftUI? We just dropped. We just dropped the target there. Big Sur, macOS 11, and or iOS 15 and earlier. Consider supporting Big Sur. In that case, do that. There's not much left. Consider showing a diff for. Okay, let me quit the move thingy. And the last 5 minutes, I will just reorganize this. Consider showing a diff for large now pages. Need to cache the content anyway. Mm-hmm. Stretch goal. Absolutely a stretch goal to do. Consider show a diff of large page contents to highlight additions, removal, version history. So users do not have to merely just read the whole damn thing. Also stretch goal. Projection sort by last updated. Projection. Yes, what does projection mean? Projection in this case means there's an array of things and it's in any order, let's say. The projection would be the sorted array. Showing full page. I don't know what this is even supposed to mean. To do sort by last updated. Add preference for sorting. Title. Oh no, wrong shortcut. This means I need to add main menu sort by macOS. Add user default. My guess, something something environment. So I'm not fluent, so I'm not sure if this should be an environment key, but I think I have prepared the environment key and user default infrastructure. Add user default environment key, and then to persist this across launches, and also, well, add substate that reflects the result. Separate the now page. Keep this sorted projection as a view model state only. Philosophical question is, what are the limits of the app state? It. necessarily one CSS, I think. We not in English class here. I'm a German. That's not German accent. I'm a German programmer with very few skill in English, so please do not judge me by the cover of my writing skills. And this is going to prepare the agenda for the upcoming videos. Make enter return commit the add no page URL form. Yes, this is a bug that needs fixing. Deletion dialog, replace connection, actual subscription, this is improvement. Adding subscription should auto select new element. Yes, handle resolve case and test. This would actually, if selection was a part of the app state, the reducer could enforce this directly. You see, if the app state only knew more, then we could have this one sweet place with all the information. But currently, that's not how things work. But it's probably not a bad idea to switch this over eventually. Redux for Swift UI with Combine. Maybe this is Fluxor. Oh yes, there's also a library. I don't really believe that I need a library for this, because you see, this looks very similar to what we have. It's interesting. It's a lens of sorts. Type of standard returns from its sectors can be based on key paths and blah blah blah. And it has a projector. And a projection is a getter that transforms the element. We can have a projecting subscription, which transforms the sorting. Philosophical questions, I'm telling you. Yep. Redux like samples on the environment. Clean architecture. Build your state nicely. I had this. I started with connectors, but didn't really like them because they required every view to know of its parts and also the state in some kind of way. Dispatching actions / events was weird. Plus minus programmatic navigation. It's just there. Why? It's related to programmatic selection. Example. Resources. Oh no, so many things. Anyway, switch to composable architecture. Why? Was this good? Open source, deep linkable. Maybe. The navigator was nice. Navigation link destination. Yes. This would be useful for to make a shortcut space navigation if we had URLs like this. But does anyone actually use that? This is a problem for future me, because current me has no clue what the best course of action is. That would be cool. To profile bottlenecks, which is actually really hard in my macOS applications when so many things are happening and reactive code is being executed, you lose track really, really quickly and the stack trace is getting worse. Minimum deployment target. Yep. Have that, have this, composable architecture, French, Korean, Indonesian, libraries. ReSwift. My little baby. Yep. Okay, future me. Have fun with that. So, this wraps up today's episode. This wraps it up indeed. We fixed a couple of minor issues and also figured out what's going to happen in the next episode. Like, this is mostly view-based code, which means I don't have to yet touch the architecture and state stuff, but still learn some things about Swift UI and the overall app layout and view hierarchy. And also, this here is going to be a segue into segue. I have no clue how to pronounce these words. This is going to be a transition into changing the architecture of the state a bit to have a selection change, a programmatic selection change, which means someone needs to listen for this new change to actually select for the user the item on screen, which means there needs to be a presenter, a state subscriber, all of the good stuff. Sheesh kebab, this is surprisingly intricate. But what I don't dislike is the look and feel of the most of the stuff here. I should maybe this needs fixing as well. Maybe earlier even. To do when scraping the website, preserve more content formatting, scraping the website. Like lists and paragraphs, headings, subheadings, maybe start with subheadings. Reduce all non-heading block elements into paragraphs. Lists. Trim leading, trailing, white space, especially before the Block level tags C met gemels script content. No, not source. I want an example. Uiuiui. Koalesca new two plus empty new lines. This should all go away. Also, fun exercise. Looking forward to this actually, to make the HTML web scrape thingy more less shitty and more pretty. That's just the best. This is the best tagline. Web scraper, less shitty, more pretty. All right. So let's end this on this high note. This episode, the now aggregator that cannot do a lot of things is going to do more things in the future. And these are the things that are going to be done. All right. I hope you enjoyed watching this. I hope you learned something. I hope you really like the tests. I hope you check out the code online. It's in the video description and somewhere else. Check out the code. Join the conversation. Create pull requests, issues. I don't care, because I do care if you create them, but I don't care what you create as long as you create something, because then I'm going to respond to your creation and handle requests and issues. I hope that made one kind of sense. Yes, some kind of sense. So see you next time. Bye bye. But how do I stop the stream here?